Well, that is a moment of significance for our next guest on many different levels. It's great to see him, as always, and he has had a busy February this year. Josh Duick joining us, Paralympian skier and world famous now, man. It's pretty weird, huh?
What the heck were we just looking at, Josh?
Something pretty cool, something pretty innovative, history being made, I suppose.
Yeah.
So tell us what that trick was that you did.
It's a backflip.
Yeah, just a backflip. First person to do it on a sit-ski.
Just a backflip.
Sit-ski.
Yeah.
I would agree.
Yeah, but on a sit-ski, I mean, you must have gone through so many, like, safety precautions to actually be able to do this. Tell us what you went through to do this trick.
Super good point. Thanks, Fiona. And thanks for having me on the show. I'm glad to be back. It's been a while.
It has been a while.
I think it was Movember last
year.
Yeah, it was. You're still rocking it, kind of.
Oh.
Every time I should have just a nice stash for you.
Yeah, I'm a little bit rough around, but... No, you bring up a good question about safety and the precautions that we took in place, and that was a huge focus all the way through the entire process, was just ensuring that everything was going to be as safe and as controlled as could be for doing this type of stunt.
Yeah, we can see you there with the airbag and everything, but maybe talk about why this was so significant for you and for your sport and for all the things that you advocate in your life.
Oh, that's it was a dream I've had since forever. Like, since literally being in the hospital, I knew that it was possible, and I put it on the back burner for a good 5 or 6 years going
into
the
Paralympics. Wait a second, when you say when you're in the hospital, this is when you first had your back injury.
Yep.
And that's what you were thinking about.
I didn't even know how to sit ski at that point in time, but I just knew that it would be possible to do. So fast forward 6 years until post 2010.
Yeah.
Racing gets put on the back burner just a little bit. I start focusing on the free ride, and as I got closer to it, I realized, you know, the gravity of what I was intending to attempt.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is a high-risk maneuver with potential huge consequence. So I wanted to make sure that I rehearsed everything as safely as possible. And if you see the film in its entirety on YouTube, you'll see that we went into a foam pit, which is like a gymnastic center.
Mm-hmm.
From there, we went up to Blackcomb and trained in their terrain park on that big airbag.
Yeah.
So two very low-consequence environments for me to perfect the jump shape.
Yeah.
The takeoff, technique, and just rehearse it over and over and over again until I felt 100% confident.
That's the physical element, but I would imagine that anytime you're doing a trick, there's a mental element to it as well, and especially for someone that, you know, had a significant injury in your sport before, how much of this was mental? Was any of it mental? Did that play into it at all?
This was a huge head game. So once we went through a lot of the rehearsal and really had it figured out, knew that it was possible, and with the guidance of a whole bunch of people that are experts in this field, we knew that it could be done and could be done
just
safely.
Physiologically?
Yeah.
Physically, we understood it. But as soon as we pinned down a date, I literally shut down.
Yeah.
So this was in December and into January, and I completely was paralyzed with fear.
Really?
I couldn't believe it. Like, I was losing sleep, and I was, like, shaking, and I was like, why am I doing this? This is stupid. Like, if I land on my head, I could break my neck.
Did you figure out the answer to that, why you're doing it?
Absolutely.
And what was it?
It's a perfect opportunity to test myself in that scenario to my intuition and to listen to it. And here's the full story. After we airbagged, we wanted to bring it onto snow right away, and we went into the backcountry up at Powder Mountain outside of Whistler, and we went out there the day after we had nailed it on the airbag 100% over and over and over, and we wanted to take that momentum, move it forward, and do it right away while it was fresh in my head.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to pull back because the weather wasn't good. You know, we went out there, and our first couple of attempts, we declined.
Yeah.
And the whole intention behind the project was, I told the guys, the producers, the filmmakers, I said, it's 50-50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, 50% says I'm going to do it, and if I do it, I'm going to stomp it.
Now, we just looked at it again, and it says Sarah on the front of your sit-ski, and she was a friend of our show here, someone you knew as well.
Sarah Burke,
Tell us about Sarah Burke and why you wrote Sarah on there.
I think a lot of riders in the industry have just taken that sticker and put it on there because she reminds us of all things good.
Yeah.
You know, Sarah's a huge inspiration to me and to so many people in the importance of living life.
Mm-hmm.
And she's somebody that did that, and she's going to be forever missed, but also forever remembered for all the good things that she did, the person that she was, and how much she contributed and gave to the sport, and how much it gave back to her.
Well, and Josh, when you look at the significance of what you've done for people outside of your sport and Paralympics and sit skiing, for people to realize the possibilities, you know, and the limitations we put on ourselves in all aspects of our lives, I mean, it's pretty amazing. I mean, that must just be sinking in for you. We're talking about, you did this at the beginning of February. We're now at the end of February. This has been a month, and this has taken on worldwide significance for people. They've really attached themselves to it. It's got to be a bit of a trip.
Yeah, fully side trip. We had no idea that this would come. And again, just kind of flashing back just for a quick second, I was talking about listening to that intuition coming down the jump.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's why we canned it at the end of January, because we weren't feeling good. Yeah. And I told the producers and the filmmakers, if I'm not feeling good, I'm not going to do it. So that was my way of curbing any expectation. Yeah. I didn't
and
really talk about...
you have to take a responsibility doing that, because most people, the adrenaline, you'd want to go, 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 go.
Yeah.
It's putting the stop on it, I think, is something that a lot of people need to learn, because your intuition in those situations when you shouldn't do something...
Yeah.
Is right.
Well, and when I was younger, you know, I'm most vulnerable to getting hurt, and that's when I was 23. I went off that jump. I wasn't listening to those signs, and I got hurt. Now, here's an opportunity for me. You asked me what my intention was, an opportunity for me to challenge those senses. I talk about it all the time. I work with WorkSafe BC and the Raise Your Hand movement, empowering young workers and knowing their rights in the workplace.
Yeah, to say
knowing
no.
that you can refuse unsafe work. So here I am in my work. You know, it's a pretty awesome job, I gotta admit, I love what I do. But here I am in what could be considered an unsafe environment.
Yeah.
At the end of January, it was snowing and windy, and I looked at the filmmakers and I said, man, this is not good. You know, I was, you know, listening to what I preach all the time, and you know, this is not a good environment, let's hold off. We waited 2 weeks, the weather finally passed and it was sunny, and I went up there and it was a perfect day, a perfect jump. I trusted the people I was working with, and I'd rehearsed it over and over again, and that fear had been completely eliminated, which was, what a wonderful feeling, right?
You know? Can we talk about the moment you landed it?
Yeah, you stomp it.
What does that feel like, to do something nobody's ever done and to inspire people? Like, you just must, that just must feel amazing.
Yeah. Well, for sure, you know, it did feel amazing, but it wasn't. Well, no, it wasn't about any of that. It was really about me overcoming those fears, and for me, it was complete liberation of that. When you see me in the air, I'm buzzing. And it's like, for a moment in time, my Sitski and my disability completely disappear. And I'm just me. I'm just a kid again.
You're gonna make me cry.
Yeah. You're gonna make me cry. It's been highly emotional how people have attached themselves to it. And the exposure it's getting, whether it be on the Ellen Show or coming here to one of my favorites locally, is
Thank
Urban
you.
Rush. Love being with
but
you guys.
What a great way to spread the message.
Well, and it's drawing the spotlight onto what is possible within the Paralympic movement and within life as a whole, within each of us. We all have this incredible potential. Now, if we're willing to persevere through the challenging times and move forward, we'll find we're capable of whatever we put our minds to.
Well, congratulations for doing exactly what you're talking about and putting words into action and getting
amazing.
Out there and just
accomplishing. Amazing. Just fun to watch. Go watch
amazing.
It a few times.
Amazing.
You still
guy.
Won't believe
I love it, man. Great to
hey,
see
thanks
you.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Next
nice
time,
to see you.
Next time, I'm going to have a sweet stash just already.
I'll come back. I'll come back. I'll be a little more groomed in place.
Thanks, Josh. And Josh was saying he supports, of course, Raise Your Hand. You
Poor
do have
BC,
the right to say no if you feel unsafe in a situation. You can go to the website to find out all the information, a little bit more inspiration from Josh as well.
Yeah, raiseyourhand.com is the website that we're talking about. We're going to take a break.